Welcome to Losing Weight the Healthy Way, and I am your presenter. I will be teaching your this class today. My name is Tori McLaughlin, and our gracious and exceptionally humble and blessed host is Alisa Green, who is the visionary officer and founder of Passport Wellness Center. And today we will be talking about how you can lose weight the healthy way. How many of us have made New Year's resolutions that we're going to eat better, we're going to live better, only to find ourselves 2 or 3 months later getting back into habits that are destructive and cause us to that are counterproductive to what our goal is? Well, today we're going to learn some principles that if we choose to walk them out will benefit us. There are four things you're going to learn today. And the first thing is biblical principles to a healthy lifestyle. And the bulk of our conversation will be right here on this point, right here. Number two, how to be healthy as you lose weight. Number three, how to be resourceful in your pursuit of health. And number four, why you want to lose weight the healthy way. And just to give you a little insight about myself, as it relates to my own journey in this, I had went through 5 surgeries in 1 year at the age of 25. And after that experience and going through the traditional medicine, I had started becoming an avid student of just learning how to take responsibility for my own health. Because I wasn't doing that before. I just basically, whatever doctor said, that's what I was going to do. And I didn't do a lot of research myself in that. So my coming in on this really wasn't on the losing weight standpoint, but it was just on the maintaining and just being healthy standpoint. And that's where a lot of my research has been, in that area. And the guiding principles that helped me through that process was first looking at scripture and reading scripture as a manual. Oftentimes we just want to read, you know, like as a devotional, we may do certain studies and certain things, but to really read the Word of God as a health manual as well helped me a lot. And so it just opened up my eyes to so many things, because the Lord wants us to be well. You know, He desires for us to be well. And as believers, we should be the healthiest people out there. Exactly. So part of that is there are some principles that God has put in place that I think that our neglecting of that has caused this problem. And so the major thing is, and we talked about it earlier, is discipline. Part of being a disciple is being disciplined. So we're going to talk about how we can be disciplined in the area of losing weight. So as we look at this, what the Lord showed me as I was trying to figure out how can I present this information in an orderly way and in a way that I can do it in a kind of time conscious way. And what He gave me was the creation week. Oh. That it actually falls in the creation week, the order of how we should govern our lives so that we can not only lose weight but be healthy. Because I think that's the goal. There is an optimum weight that we're going to function better. We're going to be able to breathe better. We're going to be able to have clarity of thought and mind, and our bodies are going to feel better so that we can do what we're called to do. Because this is not something God wants to focus on the rest of our life. This is the area that once we get this under control and under subjection to us, because we should have dominion over it, that we will be able to move into the weightier matters, the things that we are put here for. So the first thing He showed me is when we look at Genesis and we look at the creation week, what is the first thing that God puts in place?
Light.
Okay. Well, you know, I thought that too. But I'm going to give you a hint. Before He even said, let there be light, we're going to go back. Yes, but even before that,
okay.
Okay.
It was all darkness.
The first three words, before that, the first three words that we have in the Bible that tells us what God put in place is time. Because the first three words is in the beginning. And in the beginning is a denotation of time. And so when I was thinking about this, I was thinking about, you know, I've studied some on how time, when we're eating, plays a major role in our ability to lose weight. And it's like the biggest thing for me, because especially if you're working a regular schedule, you usually have your schedule set. So that means you got to be up a certain time. You know, this is the time I got to fix breakfast, this is the time I'm going to eat lunch. Everything is pretty much scheduled for you. Well, what happens when you don't have that kind of schedule? You get to set your own schedule.
Right. You kind of fly by night.
Right. Right. And so you might not eat lunch until brunch. It was just usually what I do at midday as opposed to eating early in the day. So the first principle we're going to look at, and as we look at these principles, they're done in 21-day, what I call habits. So we're taking away the bad habits that we have established, and we're putting in place godly habits. And it takes, usually they say about 21 days for something to become a habit. So when you look at all these principles, we're going to go through 21 days of doing each of these. And part of that also is to give you that buffer. And so I make it, and so I feel like this, God didn't do everything in one day. And this is what he showed me.
Right.
We don't need to feel like we need to do everything in one day. We can actually celebrate the small victory. And we can build upon that. So that even when we fail, we have a built-in failure recovery plan in our process. And so this is built that way for that purpose. Because there will be some days when we're just not going to be able to stay on schedule. But the goal is, as much as possible, to stay on schedule. He says his mercies are new every morning. So that means every morning we got a new fresh start. It's like a new day to start over. So we're going to look at time, and we're going to look at how this relates to our health. So we're going to schedule time to do the following. It's pray. Now, there are two things that are going to be the pillars of faith. There are two things that are going to be the pillars for every single step in every single stage. And the first pillar is prayer. But I want you to think in terms of strategic prayer. Because there's a scripture in the Word of God that tells us that we do not fight as one who beats the air, but have an understanding of what the will of the Lord is. We don't want to be in a position where we are not being strategic in our coming before the Father. So when I say prayer, it's going to be prayer as it relates to time and your weight. So it's going to be specific. And for you, you know, where God wants you to be in that process. And so that will apply for every single stage. It's going to be strategic prayer based on whatever stage in your development you are at. And so we're looking at prayer. The second thing is study of God's word concerning your health. We need to be strategic with that, because he tells us faith comes by hearing by the word of God. Well, we need to be reading what the word of God says about our health, things that we haven't even focused on. The biggest key I find in my study of the Word of God is that it's when I have the right question, then I seek for the answers. And so we want to ask the right questions in our path so that then we are strategic in our looking for the answers. Just like a manual. You know, we read manuals and we read them to do them, to follow those instructions. And so that's going to be a part of every process. So just keep that in your mind. The next one. Next thing is apply one thing at a time that you read in the Word of God to your life and your diet. That way you don't get overwhelmed. Because it took us a while to get whatever stage of health we are at. It's not going to happen overnight. And if it happens overnight, because I've had an overnight weight loss, it was when I was sick. You don't want it to happen that way. We want to do it the healthy way. So to do it the healthy way is a process. And in that process, it's a journey. And we taking that journey with him. Okay, and so number four,
we're going to stick to a schedule for 21 days for eating. That's the only thing you're going to do for 21 days is stick to a schedule. You're going to establish, and I know it sounds like, oh, that's easy.
That is like the hardest. I mean, I can pretty much eat anything healthy. For me, this is like the Achilles heel for me. The hardest part is being able to stick to a schedule, to actually sit down and order the day so that I know I'm going to eat this at this time, this at that time. I'm going to eat something at that time. And the goal really isn't about having large meals. So you got to think about, okay, I got to fix me some eggs and bacon and, you know, 6 o'clock in the morning. No, the goal is you want to eat before your stomach tells you you're hungry. If you wait until your stomach starts to let you know, when it starts talking to you, you waited too long. So you want to wake up. And you want to have something you can put in your mouth right there, whether it's a banana, whether it's trail mix, something that you can quickly get into your body so that you're not waiting too long and your stomach is talking to you saying, okay, you need to give me some time. That's right. So we're going to look at, does it matter when you eat to lose weight? Well, according to Paul Neeson, when you eat is just as important as what you eat. How many people eat healthy and exercise and still find themselves unable to get rid of stubborn body fat? This very well could be the link. So this could be the problem. And, you know, that's just one particular Hebrew scholar who actually studied it, but I want to give you some more witnesses to this. One of the scriptures that pricked me when I was looking at time is, to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. So being that food is so intricate to our survival, don't you think there's a certain time God designed for you to eat? I mean, to think that everything that went out of, the reason why we suffer the ability to die was because of food. So food is extremely important, and how we look at food is extremely important to our health, and it's a tool that God uses as for us to be steward over, how we use it. According to a new study, participants in the study who ate a bigger meal later in the day lost less weight than those who ate earlier. Study authors Marta Garulet and Dr. Frank Shear, director of the medical chronobiology program at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston, followed 420 people in Spain during a 20-week weight loss treatment program. The participants were split into two groups, early eaters who ate lunch before 3 p.m. and late eaters who ate lunch after 3 p.m. In Spain, lunch is the biggest meal of the day, comprising about 40% of a person's daily calories. The early eaters on average lost 25% more weight than the late eaters over the course of the study, according to Shear. So when I'm talking about scheduling when you eat, also the importance of eating a daylight diet, eating before the sun goes down. One of the things that I noticed, because in Romans 1:20, God says the invisible things of the world are clearly seen by those things which he has made, even the eternal Godhead. I used to have chickens. Went through this phase where I had chickens, and I really just sat and observed them. You know, I would watch them, and I would because of that scripture, I would actually expect that God's going to show me something I didn't understand about him through watching them, and I did. And one of the things I observed when I learned about chickens is that they live by their schedule. When I say live by their schedule, when that sun is about to come up, you're going to hear that rooster crow, and they are getting ready to come off the roost. All through the day, they are eating, playing, whatever they're going to do, they're doing it during the day. But as soon
as that sun looked like it was about to hide, oh, you better believe they're going to be right back up on that roost like clockwork, on a schedule. And when you think about it, you should be eating during the day because food is fuel. One of the things I realized is that just like a car, you don't fuel your car to let it sit for months. You fuel it to move it. And so we look at, if we change how we look at food and look at food as fuel, as something that we need for energy, and we use it for energy, we understand the concept of, well, you're going to burn more energy during the day if that's when you do most of your work. Unless you work at night, you know, I do know nurses, they'll sometimes work a different schedule. But you should eat when you're going to be burning that energy, when you're going to be burning that calorie. I mean, at nighttime, those midnight snack attacks are usually what causes the extra bulges to come on. Because you're going to sit and you're going to eat that food, and usually it's going to be comfort food, and you're going to go to sleep. So that food is going to be sitting there because it's called a bowel movement for a reason. It's not going to move until you move. So as long as you're sitting there, you got waste sitting for 8 hours just in your body, not going anywhere. So you don't want that. One of the things that God has shown me, because this is where my issue comes in right here, is the time schedule. Is when I think, because I don't eat a lot, but what happens is I starve myself for most of the day because I usually am so busy doing other things. By the time I think about food, well, it's 12, it's 1 o'clock. And then now I'm eating. Well, now I starve my body for most of the day. So now I'm actually messing up my system, my body system, because it has an alarm clock that it functions just like those roosters, just like those chickens. And so it's all out of whack, which is going to throw all other things out of whack, like your metabolism and other things that your body needs so that it can burn off fat as it ought to. So what I started realizing is that, if I'm going to address this issue, I'm going to have to understand that what God is saying when he's saying eating is, you know, what he's saying is where we talk about it every time, for every thing during the season. And I'm going to have to adhere to that time. So he showed me I have a buffet effect. And then I don't know if you're familiar with the buffet effect, but the buffet effect is this. You go through the day and you think, well, I can get more done if I just keep going and pushing myself. And you say, well, I'll just eat later on in the day. And I just go to Ryan's and I eat a buffet. And so I'm going to make up for three meals with one. Well, this is what you call, you starve yourself for most of the day, and then you stuff yourself at one sitting. This is abuse. God showed me you are abusing your body. This is the thing, these are the things that if you got a person for a form of punishment, or someone who was a prisoner of war, would use as maybe an interrogation tactic, or I'm going to starve you until you give me information. This is what we're doing to our bodies when we do that. So he had to show me that, no, you can't do that. You need to take better care of your body and eat on a schedule. We need to discipline ourselves in that area. And so I want us to go ahead and look at what's behind the study that we were just looking at. I just wanted to put that little point in there because that was very important. So, did you know your fat tissue has a built-in clock? In fact, the majority of cells in your body run on a 24-hour schedule, Shear says. The combination of all these body clocks is called the circadian system, and it's controlled by a group of cells in your brain's hypothalamus. But the clocks in individual organs, cells, can be altered by daily activity that doesn't affect the control center. For instance, researchers have found that feeding animals during abnormal times can reset the clocks in their liver and pancreas, which are key to optimizing metabolism. When this happens, the brain's central clock remains on schedule. This can result in a desynchronization between the two. That then could lead to abnormal weight gain or a decrease in weight loss.
You said it got altered with time and energy.
You're messing up your
metabolism in a negative way, not a positive way.
Right. I'm saying if you're eating outside of that clock.
Okay.
And that's kind of where in 21 days, that's what you want to find. What is your body's clock? And you want to adhere to that schedule so that all of your systems are working together. Because your body works as a system. I know in medicine, we have a lot of things like specialists in certain areas. But a lot of the problem with the specialist mentality is that your body works systemically. Every single part functions and communicates with each other. That's why you can take a medication that's for your heart and it affects your liver. Or you can take something that's for your brain and it affects something else. Because the body is a system. So everything you put in it, it's going to affect something. Either positively or negatively. So what you want to do is get on the system that's going to make your body function optimally. And part of that is going to affect your sleep pattern too. Because there's a certain time that you should sleep so that your body can restore itself. That's going back again to like those chickens. They know when to do things. We have learned how to circumvent that because we are, you know, smarter. So we figured out a way that we're going to break the system. But if we break the system, we do suffer the repercussions of breaking the system. And that's kind of what we've been doing. So now the next principle, and remember, so that's 21 days of just a schedule. You just want to get on a schedule and you want to try to eat all of your food. You can eat whatever you're going to eat during those 21 days. We're not going to focus on that. Because if you focus on what you should be eating too much, you can get off track with eating on schedule. So the goal is just to get used to eating on a schedule and eating before, as much as possible, before nighttime, which means that means you may have to get up earlier to get what your body needs to function, you know, optimally. But it does mean getting on a schedule of eating. Okay, now the second thing we're going to talk about is water. And the reason why we're going to talk about water, secondly, is because notice this about water that's so important to me. God is so orderly. Now, water covers 3 days of the creation week. The Spirit of God moves on the face of the water on day one. He separates the waters above from beneath on day two. Then he gathers the waters together on day three. That tells me water is extremely important. So how many of us are not drinking the right amount of water? And that equates to why we're having the problems we're having in our bodies. So staying hydrated could help you avoid overeating. A lot of people confuse thirst for hunger, says Peterson. So they'll tend to eat rather than drink water. If you're craving a midday snack and want to make sure your pains are caused by hunger, not hydration, have a glass of water first. Then see if you're still hungry 30 minutes later, says Peterson. So that is one of the things that you want to focus on, is you want to make sure you're drinking plenty of water and you're making, and when I say water, quality of water. That's why there's a reason why God separated the waters above from the waters beneath. All the waters that we drink are not healthful or beneficial. You know, some people say, well, that's water in sodas. Yeah, but there's other things in sodas that takes away the benefit of the water. So we want to drink the right kind of water. So the next 21-day habit for health is going to be, as we already said, prayer. Prayer is integral in all of that. 2, read your Bible and study. And 3, commit to drinking a certain amount of water per day. In your prayer time, you're going to find out, listen to what the Spirit of God is telling you. That's first and foremost. But in addition to that, because the more you know, the more you can grow, the better you can get. There are books, excellent book by Dr. Batman Jellich is Your Body's Many Cries for Water. And I actually have that on my handout, so you'll be able to get all that information. But it's a book that tells you about water and all the benefits of water. I mean, I'm just focusing on losing weight, but there are so many other benefits to water, that there are so many other sicknesses that we have, that the answer is just drinking more water. So along with that is read literature that shares the many benefits of drinking water, including how much you should drink, and that book will address that, how water helps you lose weight, and there are many resources that address that, and what other beverages counteract or build on the benefits of water. So there are certain drinks, like what I do, if you're not a water drinker and it's hard for you to get into the swing of drinking water more, one of the drinks, I try to get a 2-for-1. I keep a little bottle, actually it's a pretty big bottle, and I drink bottles out of glass. It's something else you want to look at too, when you talk about dividing water from the waters. It's a plastic. A lot of the plastic water bottles, well, depending on temperature, that plastic seeps into your water. You don't want to be drinking that. And that's why they have that kind of funny taste. If you ever drunk water and you kept in your car and it was exposed to heat and you're like, this water tastes funny. That's because there is plastic. That plastic container is molecules that are seeping into your water that you don't want to be drinking. So I try to do the glass bottles. Or if you can get stainless steel, but something that you're not going to have to worry about that happening. One of the things I do is I put enhancers, but make sure you have enhancers that are basically just fruit and vegetables, fruit enhancers that have, is just fruit in powder form. And so it gives you your vitamin C. That's why I say it's a 2-for-1. You get your vitamin C at the same time that you're getting your water intake. And it does have stevia to sweeten it. So you want something that has a natural sweetener, nothing that has any excitotoxins like aspartame or acesulfame and all these different things that are chemical names. If it's not something that grows out of the ground, you don't need to be trying to ingest it. If you got to have a degree to figure out what it means, then you might as well just say, this is not for me. So reading those labels are going to be very important, but I like to use that. And I would say don't overuse it. You know, maybe one of your, if you get a new bottle like that, maybe one of them might fill up with that and then drink it. And then the rest just drink regular water. But get into a habit for 21 days after you do your schedule. Stick on your schedule. Whatever schedule you have, stick to your schedule. Add to it 21 days of drinking water. And think of the optimum time to drink water. You want to drink water throughout the day. So definitely you want to study that out. Okay, so we see on day 3 that after the waters were gathered together and dry land appeared, that God let the earth bring forth the grass and every herb yielding seed and a fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind whose seed is in itself upon the earth. So fruits and vegetables. In this section, we're talking about fruit, vegetables, seeds, nuts, and grains. All of these things are going to be included. Basically, anything that comes out of the ground. And preferably, nothing that comes out of a lab. So, the next 21-day habit, you want to pray specifically about fruits and vegetables and in your diet and benefits that God has given us in that. You want to study God's word concerning that. You want to study in part. And start with one smoothie a day. So the first thing you want to start is 21 days of a smoothie. Just one smoothie a day. That's why I said we're taking this in steps. You're going to keep doing your water. And you're going to eat on a schedule. But one of those schedules will include one smoothie a day. The smoothie is an excellent way to get fruits, nuts, vegetables, grains, and seeds in one container at one time. And you get to optimize it because now you're not heating it where you're losing certain things. You're getting the benefit of all of that in one drink. So you would want to do a smoothie for 21 days. And keep a log of smoothies that you enjoy. I would say anyone who's going to start, if you're not a smoothie drinker, start with fruits and vegetables that you like. Because if you start with something that you don't like, and you like, oh, this is nasty, it's going to be hard for you to keep it going. Once you get a momentum of things that you like, then you can start exploring adding different fruits and vegetables to it. And even if you don't like it, by then you hook. So you'll drink it anyway because you know it's beneficial for you. Plus with you learning more about it, because again, that's why I say the key is as you learn more about it, you're going to keep it going because you know the benefits of it. And once you read the benefits of it, then you're hooked. Okay, so find out what nuts, seeds, fruits, vegetables will help you reach your health goals and incorporate that in your diet. Okay, so the next 21 days, we're going to be on day 3 for a little bit. I want you to begin in, to incorporate one salad to your routine after your 21 days of smoothie, just once a day. And it could be any kind of salad. You know, it could be a fruit salad. It could be a, you know, vegetable salad. You could put whatever meat you're going to put in it. But it just needs to be one salad a day. Okay, and after 21 days of your salad, incorporate after that 21 days steamed vegetables to at least one meal. So one of your meals, you want to have one vegetable that you have steamed. And the reason why I say steamed, because oftentimes we like to boil vegetables, but the problem is most of the nutrients is in your water. So you're basically eating dead leaves. You want to steam it because you actually retain more of the nutrients when you steam as opposed to when you boil your vegetables. And so you just want, all you're doing is adding these things, but it's just 21 days at a time. And the reason why, again, I say I do that because it builds in that failure mechanism. So if you have a day that you don't quite get it right, just get back on the next day and keep on going. Just, you know, keep on the path. That is going to be the key, because the more consistently you do it, because in life you're going to have that. You're going to have things that you're going to do. You're going to have birthdays you're going to celebrate. You're going to have events you're going to go to that you're going to get off track. But what you want to be is consistent. We don't want to make the vacation the life pattern. Right. That don't need to be the norm. That's just a vacation. But we want to make it a pattern. So we see on day 4, the very next thing God puts in place is light in the sky. He says, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. Some of the studies that they found is serotonin, which is, occurs in your brain, SAD, is a disorder that occurs when the lack of sunlight causes a drop in the neurotransmitter serotonin levels in the brain. This drop results in mood changes such as depression. Not only can a drop in serotonin levels affect your mood, it may also affect other things such as your appetite and your feelings of hunger and satiation. So you actually tend to eat more, which again, why it's at night you have the midnight snack attack when the sun goes down. So, again, we're going to talk about the hypothalamus, because the hypothalamus is like, it's a small piece of the puzzle, but it is the biggest piece as it relates to losing weight. Hunger is largely controlled by a part of your brain called the hypothalamus. The hypothalamus works with serotonin to relieve hunger. As the body reaches its needed calorie intake, serotonin is released, causing a feeling of fullness. With a lack of sunlight resulting in seasonal affective disorder, in seasonal affective disorder causing a drop in serotonin levels, this drop can result in fullness not being achieved as quickly as when serotonin levels are higher. This can cause a greater calorie intake during times when the sunlight is not as prevalent. So you actually burn more food. It's like you get a double benefit of eating during the day, during sunlight. You're going to eat less because your body's also heating up. Okay, so heat production theory. You didn't know that the lights in the sky had this much power over, over your weight loss plan, huh? So another way the sunlight may play a role in weight loss has to do with Brobeck's theory of heat production. This theory states that as the body temperature drops, you feel hungrier. As the body temperature rises, you feel less hungry. This can result in greater calorie consumption during periods with less sunlight, which can cause a fluctuation in your weight. Activity. Now, this is the one I knew without reservation. Another reason why sunlight may affect weight loss has to do with activity level. Although there are activities that can be done in the winter when sunlight is shortened, much of the population is more active during the spring and summer when the days are longer and warmer. Activities, whether hiking, camping, or going for a walk in the park, burn more calories. These added activities go a long way to increase your overall calories burned in a week, leading to greater levels of weight loss. And one of the things I want to talk about here as it relates to that is, if I don't know about you, but I have seasonal clothing, and I'm a seasonal size. Spring and summer, I'm a lot lighter than I am in winter and fall. And this is why. Because usually when it's colder, you don't want to be more active. You don't want to go outside. One of the blessings to not just doing it, try to do it yourself, especially you're trying to yourself, you don't have momentum. It's good to have an accountability person, especially when it's cold. One of the blessings of Pastoral Wellness Center, for those who don't know, I think everybody can find it. Lisa does training. But one of the things I appreciate about her, other than just, and we talk about it, being a personal trainer, is that she's a life coach. So she's not just here to help you lose some pounds and get to a desired size. She's going to be concerned about you being strengthened where you were weak, by you being able to do things you weren't able to do before, so that you were able to function better. And she's going to be concerned about you reaching your goal. Because the bottom line is, weight loss shouldn't be something we have to focus on every day of our life. This is not God's plan. It's something that we should focus on until we get to where we're supposed to be, so that now we are able to do the things that God has called us to do. And that's one of the blessings of being partnered with someone, not just a personal trainer, but also a life coach, because they are going to be concerned about that, not just about you losing, you know, your weight. And you don't want to just be concerned about you losing weight, and only that anyway, because you may lose weight, but you might suffer some other issues. If you got a personal trainer, like, okay, well, I'm going to help you reach your goal, but then they help you reach your goal, you end up having some physical and medical problems because of what they're pushing you to do before your body's able to do it. So it's good to have someone who's concerned about the long haul. So for your next 21-day habit, in addition to eating on a schedule, drinking plenty of water, your smoothie, your salad, your steamed vegetables, you want to add walking, running, and biking for 30 minutes a day. We have to change how we look at things. I know a lot of people say, well, I don't have time to exercise. You have time. It's what you're doing with that time. Because we all, that's one thing that no matter whether you're rich, poor, we all got that. No matter what. Even a rich person can't get somebody else to exercise for them. We've got to do it ourselves. There's no way around it. Now, there are things that you can do that makes it easier. If we change our culture, because our culture is centered around food. That's our form of entertainment. Even think about it. Even as children, I substitute tea sometimes. What we give is treats, is food. We're going to give them candy. That's what they're going to get. You're good, we're going to give you candy.
That is so wrong.
We've got to change that culture about that. We don't need to be giving stuff that's going to cause you to have problems later on. And if we make food the focus of our treat, then we're not going to be able to reach our goal. So one of the things you can do is, if you work a job and you get an hour lunch, say, hey, we're going to do 30 minutes. We're going to bring our own food. We're going to eat. And then we're going to do 30 minutes of walk. Walk with a coworker that other 30 minutes. If you're going to be going out with your girls, having a girls' day, it doesn't have to be centered around food. We can center it around other things. You do it with something active. You know, go bowling. We're going to go bowling. And we're going to do that for our girls' day. You know, or we're going to have dinner at our house, and we're going to, you know, talk around a table. What happened to that? You know, all those sorts of things that we can do where we don't have to make the focal point around food. So the second thing is, complete a project that requires you to be active, such as take part in a community project. That's another thing you can do. I'm a two-for-one type person. For me, it took me a minute to get the 30-minute walk and commit to that, because I am so like, okay, I need a 2-for-1, a 3-for-1. I need to see where I'm accomplishing something. So I'm more apt to, if you're trying to demo your house, give me a call. I'm more apt to, let me help
you. You can come help landscape.
There you go. Exactly. Garden, you know, all that kind of thing. If you know, starting a little league, things that you can do where now it's not just about you, and or now it's about you, but you're actually doing something that's going to have different benefits to it. So one of these things you can do, and consider joining Pastoral Wellness Center. If you are not local, find a personal trainer, preferably a life coach as well, in your area that will be committed to you being healthy and not just losing weight. Okay, so now I'm about to touch what is a big thing I know in Louisiana culture. I learned that when I moved out here, and that is the meat. So, and God said, let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creatures that have life and fowl that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of heaven. So how many of you ever thought about the fact that this was all orderly, done in order? How we should eat and putting everything in a schedule, things that were priority that we should do. That it makes perfect sense.
Yeah, it does. I thought about the orderly process that he did, but not in reference to how we eat.
Right. And so I think it's so awesome because to me, the fact that the exercise part, the activity part, would come before the meat part says a lot too. Yeah. You know what I mean? Because meat is the hardest thing for your body to digest. Mm-hmm. So I could see where exercising and having a firm foundation in doing that would help you to be able to better deal with incorporating, you know, your meat and all the other stuff that's hard to digest. So next 21-day habit. And remember, original diet, meat wasn't even in it. So he was just, it was just the fruits and vegetables. So all you had to do then was tend the garden. Had the exercise put in place because he already had a job for everybody. Meat came along later. So next 21-day habit, we're going to pray, we're going to study what the Bible says, consider fishing five. And this book, I have it so you can see it if you like, but this book, what the Bible says about healthy living, this book you want to read, I say, with like a manual. Because if you read it with the Bible, it actually gives you the scriptures. So you can actually study specifically on fish and fowl. And he'll tell you, you know, he explains what animals were clean and unclean. And then he's going to explain from a scientific, from a doctor standpoint, he's going to explain why certain animals, he said, were not clean, why you shouldn't even eat it. Because the key to it is, as you understand that, you understand God had a built-in plan for reasons why he said not to eat these things. So I think we should at least know why he says not to eat these things before we dismiss whether or not we have to eat it or not. So you want to eat the biblical diet of clean fish for 21 days and fowl. Stay away from the land animals. You just want to incorporate the fish and fowl that are clean for 21 days. Now that is in addition to eating on a schedule, drinking plenty of water, getting your fruits and vegetables, exercising. That's right, your smoothie, salad. Your salad, your steamed vegetables.
Let's see, what 21 day cycle are we on here?
Okay, well yes, it's 7 cycles.
Yeah.
But the goal is once you get through the cycle, it becomes a habit. Then it's just a part of what you do. It's not, you don't even have to think about it. You want it to be foundation like your ABCs. I don't have to keep going back over the ABCs.
Right.
I just know them. Yeah. That's how you want to be about food. Because once we get the food issue out of the way, you know how many more conversations we need to have that this society needs to hear from believers that they're not hearing because we're focusing on things that God said, these are elementary things. We should already have this under control. Okay, so and God said, let the earth bring forth a living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping thing, and beasts of the earth after his kind, and it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth after his kind, and cattle after their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the earth after his kind. And God saw that it was good. So now we're going to deal with land animals. This book, again, is what you need, because he deals with all of these. So you want to pray, you want to study what the Bible says concerning land animals, and you want to, in addition to reading this book, do your own personal research and find out the wisdom of God's diet for your body. Because you'll find that there's wisdom in God's word, and there's wisdom, there's research that's just now catching up with what God already said, that's, you know, implicating that, hey, this diet makes sense. It's better for us. Okay, so eat only the biblically clean meat for 21 days, in addition to what you already have been doing. So now you can eat your land animals, you can eat your cows, you can eat your deer. You're just going to incorporate all that in your in your diet. So now we come to the day, after 6 days of work, what did God do?
You rested.
Yeah. And we all like vacations, right? So on the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work, which he had made, and God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work, which God created and made.
So, we're going to look at rest. Are we getting the proper amount of rest? I know some people don't think that this is important to your health, much less your weight, but your body was made to rest. Getting proper sleep and getting it at the proper time will assist you in your weight loss efforts. Are we giving our bodies rest from food? Fasting was a part of the Hebrew culture. And in fact, one of the feasts that was given to the Hebrews required that they were not to eat on that day. Your body needs to rest from the day-to-day assault it has to deal with from the frankenfoods we feed it. Even partial fast can help your body get the boost it needs to fight another day. And we see fasting, we see Daniel, you people do Daniel fast, we see all the scripture, these are things that were done. What I say is, what the world called detoxing is just also another form of fasting. It just don't necessarily connect the spiritual part to it, but if you staying away from something for a period of time. So one form of fasting, and the one I am referring to, is detoxing. This, as scripture always reveals it, is one that should be spirit-led. First and foremost, what type of fast you do is essential to know. One shouldn't jump into detoxing without knowing what their goal is. Scripture tells us that we do not fight as one that beats the air. In the context of losing weight, we need to be strategic in our planning. Some people, they need to stop drinking. Alcohol is the source of their weight. For others, they have a sugar craving that is out of control. Well, you need to know what is going on inside of you that is causing you to crave sugar and target that area of your body. Bottom line is, you need to know what is going on inside of you and fast accordingly. Know the root cause of your sickness. So if your issue is, you know, you find that you're eating lots of sugar, I need to fast from that. If, you know, so, but all of that is going to be based on your, it's going to come out of your prayer time and your studying the word, and the more that you're doing that, which is why it's built into the process, the more you're going to know by this time, yeah, this is an area I have a weakness in that I might need to get rid of for a minute and focus on some other things. Simply put, detoxing is a break in the routine of business as usual. You are providing necessary rest to some part of your body from the uninvited toxins that certain foods bring to it. And you are feeding it instead nourishing ingredients that your body needs, which may not be in agreement with your taste bud. Many people successfully lose weight on a detox alone. But here is the question you have to ask yourself. What do you think will happen if you finish a detox and return back to the habits you had before you started this process?
Kind of detox again.
Exactly. The weight don't come back. You will gain the weight you lost and possibly become even bigger than before. And one of the scriptures I always think of, and I think of this, is the man who, the parable that Jesus gives about the man who, he had his house was swept clean, demons left, he was free from them. And then what happened? Demons see that it's swept clean in there.
Right back.
Come back with seven friends. And to say that man is worse than four. We don't want that to happen. So that's why you want to do it in stages. And that's why you want to do it as a process. Because once it becomes routine, it becomes habit, then you're consistent. If you get the fast detox and you lose the 20 pounds and then they drop, but then you go back to saying, well, I'm going to go back to eating what I used to eat. Now you're doing it. You're creating a yo-yo for your body, and your body is being affected by that yo-yo. It's the consistency that's going to bring the blessing. Okay. So the next 21-day habit is pray concerning the current state of your health. Commit to researching online or at the library on detoxing. Learn the benefits of detoxing and research the different aspects of it. There are many books and resources available on this. The terminology you will find is detox, cleanse, or fast. All three accomplish the same thing, removing what doesn't belong in your body and putting back what the body needs. If you are not led to fast after 21 days of prayerfully pursuing the Father, just continue doing what you have been doing. That's it.
So how many cycles of 21 days have we gone through? Water?
You're going through time.
Time.
Water.
Fruits and vegetables.
The fruits and vegetables are three right there.
Oh, okay.
And then you have exercise. So that's six right there. And then after exercise, you have fish and fowl.
Fish and fowl.
Then you have your land animals. And then you have, so it's nine. And then
okay.
You have your rest.
Yeah, smoothie, fruits, and smoothie, salad,
yeah.
And the steamed, that's all under day three.
Okay.
Yes, because it's all vegetables.
Okay.
But see, the part of the benefit of that is giving you also time to find recipes that you will enjoy without
that's
the stress.
That's about 190 days, right?
About that. I have it written on my...
That's about a little over 6 months. All right. Yeah, that's a good investment in your lifestyle.
Amen. Okay, so how to be healthy as you wait. Be prayerful about everything that you do. Be wise. Apply a principle of scripture to your quest.
Be able to ask yourself sensible, I'm going to read from here because I can read it better from here, questions as you research. If a course of action doesn't make sense to you, then you shouldn't follow it until you do. Where there is fear instead of peace, it is not God. He doesn't give us a spirit of fear, but calls us to peace. His signature is peace. So if you don't have peace about a situation, you pray and continue researching until you have it. Be consistent. If you are looking for a magic pill or an overnight success story, then this program won't work for you. The goal is not to lose weight today and gain it back 6 months later, but rather to change your mind concerning your stewardship of your body and ask yourself if you are being a good steward. Are you making Christ-like decisions as it relates to the temple he gave you on earth? This is not for vanity purposes, but for God glorifying, preparing the next generation for the things that will shortly come upon the earth purposes. Our poor choices affect more than just us. 4, seek accountability. Our health is important enough that we should be willing to pay at least as much as we pay for our cell phone plans each month. At least as much as that. Be committed. Being committed to someone or something doesn't mean you don't make mistakes or fall off the bandwagon sometimes. It means that if you fall off the bandwagon, you get back up. People make mistakes in marriages, relationships of all sorts all the time, but not all people abandon ship when they do. Being committed to your health means that you aren't going to accept failure as an option. You are not going to weigh your success by the numbers on the scale, but by your sticking to the written plan. Losing weight the healthy way means that you are developing healthy habits that will keep you the desired weight you were designed to be by God, so that you can accomplish the purposes that he destined for you from the foundation of the world.
So let's back up to number 4 for a second.
Okay.
Can we do that?
Okay, how do I go back?
Well, that's all right. I can just talk. It says about spending the money, same amount of money as you spend on your cell phone a month. So that money would be what you would spend on food, exercise, water, whatever.
Where you're spending that anyway.
I know.
Right. But you got to eat
over that amount.
But I'm saying, like, if you're needing someone, in other words, if you know you can't consistently do it on your own,
sure,
you're gonna need help. So if whether that's joining a gym, Passport Wellness Center,
mm-hmm,
whether that.
Or accountability. Okay.
Right. Having someone who's going to.
Of all of
yes. Yeah. Or that could be just investing in a good blender.
Yeah.
You know? Because I know somebody people who will spend hardly nothing in a blender, but then they don't use it as much,
yeah,
because it's not functional for them.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard for them to clean. It takes too much time, or the stuff they want to make, they can't get the taste they want because that blender wasn't created to do that. You know, you have to know wattage is very important. We're going to talk about that when we get the smoothie. So blenders are, you know, you want to get something that's going to be valuable. So how to be resourceful in your pursuit of health. You want to be a smart, do smart shopping. And one of the things that I have provided in the worksheet is how you can be a smart shopper. So in other words, there are, like, if you want to eat as much as possible organic, and certain things you will be more discriminate on being organic than others. Like, I'm not huge on you got to have organic bananas because the hull is right. But I mean, things that, you know, people going to be, they spraying poison directly on that you that has no hull,
right.
You need to be more concerned about that. So I wouldn't take, because I know how greens grow, I wouldn't take greens. If I can get some greens that are organic, I prefer that.
Okay.
Simply because, or grapes, right, because you're eating a whole fruit. But if you're talking about oranges or bananas, then yeah, you know, just, I can't, if I got to choose what my budget can afford, I'm going to get regular oranges, bananas, and I'm going to make sure I spend the extra on getting me some green leafies that are organic. Being a servant. One of the things that in the exercise process is by your being willing to say, hey, well, I'm going to do a Habitat for Humanity. Not only are you helping somebody build a house, but you're getting your mobility. You're getting some exercise. You're doing something beneficial. So sometimes just being a servant helps. And then you're also getting accountability buddies, because as you're losing weight and they're seeing how you're feeling better, how you have more energy, how, you know, everything is picking up, then now you get to serve them and bring them along. Okay, developing reward system. That's what we were talking about earlier. Developing reward systems that's going to work, not ones that's going to hurt. So in other words, you don't want to say, okay, I did 21 days of this, so now I'm going to treat myself by going to Baskin and Robbins and I'm going to give me 31 flavors of ice cream. We don't want to make that our treat for 21 days of staying on a habit. We want to make our treat something, well, okay, if there's a dress or something that you really wanted, but you didn't want to get it because you didn't like the size you were. Well, you get the size you want to get, let that be a treat. You know, change how you see how you treat yourself for or reward yourself, your reward system for what you do. Knowledge is power. The biggest key to being able to stay on this is the more you know about what you're doing, the less you want to do what you're doing. That is critical. If you, I mean, I think alone, if people would actually have the chance to see the facilities that their meat is coming from, they would probably change the brand of meat that they eat. Yeah, so I think just having that knowledge and knowing that, that's going to help. And in fact, I know that for me, that's what helped a lot. After I went through those surgeries, I was like, whew, that was an eye-opener for me. So I begin to say, okay, there's certain things I need to know about food and how it's working in my body. And once I was informed, it was easy for me to say, okay, well, I really don't need this to live. I can say goodbye. I can let it go. The cheap comes out expensive. I don't know if y'all watch Marilyn Million, but sometimes I like to watch her because she's a trip on People's Court. But she says this, and this is such a true statement. The cheap comes out expensive. Know what you should save up for and what you can save pennies on. So when I say that, if you're investing in your health, it is better for you to get a NutriBullet versus a cheap blender that costs you $5. And I'm going to tell you why. Because if you're going to be drinking smoothies every day, it's not going to last. That motor is not meant to take. If you got a motor that's 300 or 400 watts, it is not meant to handle frozen fruits, especially when you start talking about if you do figs or strawberries. Strawberries alone could tear it up.
Oh yeah, frozen strawberries.
Yes,
oh,
frozen
yeah.
Strawberries, because they get rock hard. So you want something that's going to make it. So that might be your treat. You might say, hey, I'm going to save my money and buy me a blender that I know has a wattage that can handle what I'm going to want to do with it. Okay.
So the reason you want to be with health, taking ownership of your health. Everyone needs to do this. I'm a big advocate of this. Your life is too important to leave into somebody else's hands. There's not one scripture that tells us to trust man. Not one. I don't care who we. We are to trust God. We trust God in man, but we can't put our full trust in man because, like us, they are subject to failure. So we've got to take ownership of our health. We have to know if this course of action, what are going to be the positives and negatives. We want to make sure that there's more positives to be gained than negatives. And if there are going to be potential negatives, we want to be prepared for that too, so that we can counteract that as possible. Seeking wise counsel from the creator of your vessel. That is key to just about everything. And creating a legacy of health for generations to come. How we eat is how our children are going to eat. How they're going to tell their kids how to eat. How people around us are going to eat. We influence people by how we live. So it does matter how we live. It does matter how we eat. Because if we aren't careful about that, then it's going to transfer to whoever we say we love. And they're going to think, okay, it's okay. Well, they're doing it.
Right.
I can do it. And especially, I believe that's one of the main things. If you have kids in your house, you have to tell your kids, well, they friends who are believers. And they say, well, they're Christians too, but they watch this or they do that. The first thing we say, well, not in our house. We don't do it. So if we need to have it said of our culture that not in our house are we going to eat in a way that's going to be counterproductive to our health.
That is the end of my presentation on losing weight the healthy way. I sure hope that something was said that blessed you. I pray that the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob will give you a blessing through this teaching. And I hope that I will be able to continue. If it be the will of God, that I'll be able to continue to give you more teachings that will help you on your quest for losing weight the healthy way. Just for your information, I am currently working on a study guide, a booklet to go along with this teaching for each and every one of the steps, the healthy habits that you choose to embrace, so that it can just help you with your day-to-day, putting the Lord first and keeping yourself orderly and organized. And any additional information about this teaching or any other teachings that I offer, please visit my website at lifereadytutoring.wordpress.com. If you like to read more articles or hear more teachings from me, then please visit my website, transformationlifestyle.wordpress.com. I hope this has inspired you. I pray that God has given you an amazing blessing and insight and revelation on how you can live a healthier life, not just for yourself, so that you can also transform your household and then hopefully a nation. And so that is the end of my presentation. I pray that you be blessed.